Good morning. If I could have your attention, we'd like to have a scripture reading to get us focused on the Lord and prepared for worship. So I'll read from Isaiah chapter 1, 16 to 20. Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, remove the evil of your deeds from before my eyes, cease to do evil, learn to do good, seek justice, correct oppression, bring justice to the fatherless, plead the widow's cause. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be eaten by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
Hello, good morning and welcome. If you're visiting at 10th, I want to warmly welcome you here this morning. You have a bulletin. We'll be using that shortly for the doxology and for prayer together. It's our joy to welcome to our pulpit this morning Dr. Kent Hughes, who is the new professor of practical theology at Westminster Theological Seminary. Technically makes him my boss because I help out doing some homiletics this next fall semester. So if I'm not doing it next year, it's because he's fired me. Previously, he was minister at College Church in Wheaton. He's written many books, and I'm sure that most of us will know his name if we've never heard him in person ourselves. Well, we've come this morning to worship God together, and I want to read from Psalm 65 and verse 4 these words: "Blessed is the one you choose and bring near to dwell in your courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of your house, the holiness of your temple." Confess our sins together as God's people. So if you can, please join us as we pray using the words you'll find in the bulletin. Let's all pray. O God, our Father, you are our creator, and we are the work of your hands. You are our shepherd, and we are your flock. You are our redeemer, and we are the people you have brought back. We have sinned against you and against others. We repent of all our sins and ask for your forgiveness. We pray that you would not remain angry with us, that you would not recall our sin to punish it, but that you would continue the work you have begun in us by your Spirit, that the whole earth may recognize that you are God, our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Hear these words of assurance and pardon from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. "For our sake, he, that is the Father, made him, the Son, to be sin, who knew no sin, that so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Almighty God, our Father, we bow before you this morning, acknowledging that you are our Creator and our Redeemer in Christ. As our Creator, everything we are, our breath, our being, belongs to you. As our Redeemer, our gratitude, our thanksgiving, our hopes of glory, everything depends on you. And so we come right at the very beginning to acknowledge you to be our God, to worship you, to praise your name, to give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's pray together, shall we? Let's all pray. We come to you, our God, the Lord of hosts, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and our dear Father by adoption and by the Son's authority, by his work, our Father in heaven. We bow before you. We come to acknowledge you to be the Lord who controls all things, that you have ordained whatever comes to pass, that you are moving history towards the great climax, when at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord, to the glory of your great name. We thank you and praise you for him who from all eternity has shared the fullness of the Godhead with you, Father, and the Spirit. We thank you that it was by him that you made all things, that it is through him that you uphold all things by the word of his power. We thank you for his obedient life. We praise you for his sacrificial death on our behalf, in our place, bearing our sins and sorrows and making them his very own and taking that burden to Calvary and suffering and dying alone in our place. We thank you that you raised him from the dead. We praise you that you have installed him on Zion, your holy hill, that is that heavenly throne from which you govern the universe that you have made, and that you've given to him the nations as his inheritance. We come today to your throne conscious that we live in a world of over billions of wills that are in opposition to your will. We think of the people of the world who are gathered together against you as the Lord and against your Messiah Jesus, quite specifically. We live in such a place where the wills of millions of people all around us are hostile to your will revealed in your word. We live in a world where there are billions of people whose wills are hostile to your will. And there are those whose threats, whose mockeries subvert the cause of God and seek to destroy the church of God. There are those of our brothers and sisters today whose blood is being spilt because they name the name of Jesus. There are many who find themselves marginalized, misrepresented, and mistreated because they name the name of Jesus. In the press, even in our more liberal society, in which there are safeguards still under the law, nonetheless, even in our society, increasingly, we find ourselves pilloried and misrepresented in the media. And so we come to you. We cry to you. Our brothers and sisters, the martyrs, they cry to heaven. They cry, "How long, O Lord? How long before you vindicate your church? How gracious you are to hold back, as it were, the fullness of your wrath against a world in hostility towards you. How gracious you are, because this Jesus whom they despise, you have made both Lord and Christ, and you have urged the nations, as you are just this morning, kiss the Son, lest he be angry." And as we move towards that great denouement at the end of history, when he will judge the nations, we pray that you would cause men and women to call on his name, that there may be an ingathering into the kingdom of God of people that you have brought to faith in the Lord Jesus. To this end, Lord, we pray for those who have been touched and reached through our various mission trips over the summer, the latest one in Northeast Philadelphia. We pray, Lord, for the work being done through the church plants that we oversee and encourage among ethnic groups and refugee groups of people here in this great city. We pray for our mission partners in different parts of the world who are seeking to name the name of the Lord Jesus, sometimes in very hostile environments, in places we can't even mention publicly for their safety's sake. But we pray, Lord, that you would use them. We ask that men and women would come to know you as their Savior and their Lord. And we pray for our people here, living and working in America, who seek to pursue their everyday life, conscious that they live it under the eye of their Heavenly Father. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to love our neighbors. We pray that we would do our neighbors good, that we would enhance their life and the life of our nation. We pray that you would help us to love our enemies and to pray for them, and to ask that you would give them the ultimate blessing, which is reconciliation to you by the blood of the Lord Jesus. We pray that you would help us day by day to do the little things that enhance the lives of others, that disarm people's antagonism, that in our neighborhoods and in our workplaces, in our schools, we would, by our good works, glorify your name, our Father, and that you in turn, by your grace, would turn many hearts towards you, that you yourself, in your Son, our Lord Jesus, would be glorified. In his strong name we pray. Amen.
We'd like to welcome you to our worship today. And if you're visiting, we encourage you to fill out one of the pew cards and drop it in the offering plate or in the oak box in the narthex as you leave. We also have a little welcome center table in the narthex where you can get more information about the church. Look at our bulletin or our website about some of the upcoming activities of the church. Today, City Network, 10th City Network, it's a group of 20s and 30s, are having a lunch out today, meet out in front of the Spruce Street, in front of the church, and to go out to eat together. Tonight, at the evening service at 6:30, that will include the Lord's Supper. Today, we're having a baptism, three baptisms, and I'd like to just say a few words about baptism as they come out. God's solemn pledge to us in our baptism gives us great assurance and hope. Peter preached to the crowd on the day of Pentecost, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children, and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself." We see here that baptism represents the forgiveness of sins and for receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. God's promise of receiving these blessings was not only for his hearers, but also for their covenant children and the Gentiles, those living far off. Thus, we see in the New Testament that as someone came to believe, they and their whole household were baptized. The sign given to us by God that our children are children of promise is baptism. So they are within the covenant community, the church, because they have at least one believing parent by which they are considered holy, according to 1 Corinthians 7:14. Baptism is the new covenant sign and seal of the same covenant that God had made with Abraham, signified with circumcision. The sign changed because Jesus was circumcised for us through his bloody sacrifice at the cross. Now he has sent his Holy Spirit to live within us. As Christian parents, their child, they are to be brought up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord and discipled to observe all that Jesus commanded, as we are commissioned to do by Jesus. And why do we use water? Baptismal water signifies the blood of Christ, which takes away both original and actual sins and establishes us in a covenant relationship with God.
spiritual washing with the word, so that we may be born again of water and the Spirit. The sanctifying work of the Spirit of Christ against the control of sin over us and the corruption from our sinful nature. Anointing through pouring out of the Spirit upon us for service and ministry. The blood of the Lamb shed at the cross that conquers the accuser of our brothers, Satan and his demons. And passing through judgment for sin that was borne by Christ on our behalf. So all those things are the meaning of water in our baptism. So those being baptized today are Henry Franklin Lanzone, born October 22nd, 2014, son of Timothy and Sarah Lanzone. Theodore Michael Curran, born February 13, 2015, son of Kevin and Jacqueline Curran. And Juliet Lily Carnes, born February 22, 2015, daughter of Timothy and Catherine Carnes.
Thank you, Bruce, for an extended treatment. Bruce has written on covenant baptism, and it would be good for you to try and read what he's written on the subject. Well, I have some questions for you as parents. Let me just remind you of three passages of Scripture. The first in Genesis 17, where God's speaking to Abraham, "I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you." And then the promise repeated in Acts chapter 2, "For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself." And then the example of a believing household in Acts 16, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your family." So in light of that, here are the questions I have for you. Do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you?
Yes.
And do you claim God's covenant promises on their behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for his salvation as you do for your own? Do you? And do you now unreservedly dedicate your child to God and promise in humble reliance on God's grace that you will endeavor to set before them a godly example, that you will pray with and for them, that you will teach them the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Do you? Yes. And do you as a congregation undertake the responsibility of assisting these parents in the Christian nurture of their children? Do you?
Yes.
Okay. Who's this?
Juliet.
This is Juliet. Romeo and Juliet. Can you see her? There she is. Juliet, may God grant you grace to walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us. Juliet, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Girl, God be with you.
Thank you so much.
Who's this?
Theodore Mike.
This is Theodore. There he is. Here's your public. Theodore, of course, means God's gift. Theodore, your name means God's gift, and you are that to your parents. May he give you the free gift of life, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Theodore, I baptize you into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Good boy. And this is
Henry.
Hi, Henry. Yeah. You're a happy boy. Happy as long as you can see Mum.
Yes.
Maybe you.
Me.
He is funny, isn't he? He makes us laugh too. Henry, we pray that you would be a man of faith. May the Lord oversee your home and family while your eyes are fixed in Jesus. We baptize you In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Goodbye. Shall we pray for these children? Father, thank you for these children, for the joy they've brought to their parents and the wider family. We pray, Father, that you would confirm these children in the promises that you have made to them, to their parents today. We pray, Father, you would draw them to yourself, that in due course they might profess openly and publicly Jesus as their Lord, to the praise of your glory. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we trust in you and you alone, for you are our source of life and the giver of everything that we have. And so we seek to be faithful stewards of what you've entrusted to us for your honor and glory. And so we give our gifts with great joy and for the extension of your kingdom here and throughout the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Turn in your Bibles to our scripture reading. You'll find it on page 462 of your pew Bible, Psalm 32. Psalm 32. A Maskil of David. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found. Surely, in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Be not like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed with bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, it is an immense pleasure to be with you this morning. I've, over the years, preached occasionally here through the preceding pastors, and it's great to be here with the present pastor and colleague at Westminster. So, an immense privilege to open the word to you. As Psalm 32 has been read this morning, I think you want to keep your Bibles open to that as we look at this magnificent text, which sings ultimately of forgiveness. And if you're just turning there to consider Psalm 32, you want to note that St. Augustine, the great Augustine of Hippo, author of the Confessions of the City of God, whose writings influenced nearly every sphere of Western culture, considered this to be his favorite psalm of all. In fact, his favorite scripture, I think, his very favorite. And he read it continually throughout his life, and at the end of his life, he had it inscribed above his bed so that when he went to sleep at night, in the last light of day, as it closed down on him, he would see Psalm 32 in front of him, and when the sun rose in the morning, it would illumine him in the first light of dawn, informing his sleep and informing his walk during the day. For him, being who he was, with his past, with his life in Christ, it was an essential of spiritual life. That's a great thing to know, and you'll then also note right at the beginning, as we read this morning, it's called a Maskil. There are only 13 of the 150 Psalms which are called a Maskil, and it means variously a song of meditation, a scriptural song, a song of understanding, and I think it's kind of agreed. If you bring that all together, the idea seems to be that it is a teaching psalm, a psalm of instruction, or a sung meditation. So to music, you'd have the kind of the lyrics of forgiveness running through your heart and soul. And if you look at the text, you'll also note very quickly that there is Selah in the margin three times. Probably means pause or crescendo or musical interlude, but not know exactly what it means, but it has to do with musical accompaniment and certainly would denote emphasis. So I think it's reasonable to say when you see that, it's kind of time to take a breath and reflect. Maybe there was a musical interlude, but a time to think upon the heavy thoughts that have just been enjoined in the paragraph in front of you. And then keeping this in mind, you should also understand this is a penitential psalm, that there are six penitential psalms. Our mind automatically goes to Psalm 51, but there are four other penitential psalms. And that penitential is not a title that you'll find in front of the psalms, but they were seen to speak to this matter of penitence and repentance and forgiveness by the ancient church, and that is certainly true of Psalm 32. It does it so perfectly. When the great Galileo was in prison for teaching the Copernican view of the universe, he was imprisoned by the church. As part of his incarceration, he was forced to read all seven penitential psalms, or seven of them, once a week for 3 years. And his jailers thought that that would cause him to repent of his views. But psalms only served, he says, to elevate and console his heart, as well they should. And we also understand clearly that the psalms lead to spiritual correctness, not political correctness, not intellectual correctness. So it was good for his soul. And you see that it's also a psalm of David, and it was written after his repentance under the scathing denunciation of Nathan, when he probably stuck an index finger in David's face and said, "You are the man for committing adultery with another man's wife, that is Bathsheba." And then to cover up the adultery and cover up the pregnancy, putting her husband in line in battle, her loyal husband, by the way, where then he died. And so it was a homicide. I mean, heinous sins, awful sins, which he did not repent from for over a year. Now, we know that King David wrote Psalm 32 because it says so right in the beginning. It's the Maskil of David. We know that he wrote Psalm 32 because it perfectly mirrors his misery and unrepentance and then his repentance. And we know he wrote Psalm 32 because Romans chapter 4 has Paul attribute the opening two verses of Psalm 32 to David. So it's a Davidic psalm, no doubt about it. And today, the great psalm tugs at the heartstrings of our lives because it captures the experience. And it really does. This is about as poignant and penetrating as you can be, the experience of every believer in their experience of sin and unrepentance and then repentance. It does play our heartstrings in. So no wonder Augustine loved it. The mental image I have of Augustine is lying in his bed or his cot with the inscription in Latin above it and meditating on it as he dozed off and as he woke up, as we said. Now, what it does is this psalm points the way to forgiveness and blessedness, and it has two natural divisions. Verse 1 through 5 are biographical. So it's David talking about his experience in 1 through 5, and then 6 through 11 is a challenge, a penetrating challenge that he gives. And the psalm is ageless, as old as sin, if you want to say, and as fresh as grace, because it just drips with grace. Now, David begins the story with an initial shout of praise after having been forgiven the terrible threefold grip of sin. So those opening two verses are packed with praise. I'll read them. "Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. Now, King David purposely used three words to describe the full dimensions of sin, and you see them right there in the text. In verse 1, he uses transgression. Then again, in verse 1, he uses the word sin. And then in verse 2, iniquity. Bringing those three nuances together to talk about the fact of his being totally, utterly dominated by sin. Now, transgression, that first word in verse 1, emphasizes a willful act of rebellion against God's authority. Because whatever sin is, it is rebellion against God. So he rebelled. Next, he uses the word sin in the full metaphorical sense of missing the mark as an arrow falls short, because his life fell so short of God's grace and God's expectations. And then the third term that he uses in verse 2 gives this kind of terrible triad of iniquity, because the iniquity, because it means crookedness or criminality, that he twisted and was perverted into a criminal conduct. And when you look, stand back and look at the horrific abuses of Bathsheba and Uriah, you see those things. As the king and psalmist, David intimately knew his law. Deuteronomy, which gives the rules for kings, Deuteronomy 17, 18, and 19, specifically directed David as king of Israel to copy a copy of the law, the Torah, out in his own hand in Hebrew. You can imagine the time it took to do that, and that he was to keep it before him all of his days, that he might conduct himself and live according to the law. So he knew the law, yet he sinned with a high hand. And then his life fell shamefully short because he had a special covenantal charge in his high call as king, and what a miserable shortfall he had. And then his soul was twisted and warped in his conduct. And as we know, this threefold sin is described, the depth of his sin took him down to the utter depths of misery and guilt, so that he was literally throbbing with guilt. Absolutely dominated. And here, again in verses 1 and 2, as he begins his penitential psalm, as we said, he celebrates forgiveness with a corresponding trio of deliverance terms. And you can see them in order. Forgiven, covered, counts no iniquity. His sin is literally forgiven. It was lifted and taken away, utterly forgiven. And then his sin was covered. This miserable Hebrew king had been frantically trying to cover his nakedness, so to speak, always to find it uncovered. And shame and fear dominated this exposure in his waking moments, even his dreams. But his sin has been covered by God himself. And lastly, the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, is God's way of dealing with sin. And it anticipates the New Testament teaching, as we're going to see, where God credits or counts righteousness to those through faith and does not count our sins against us. Great theological word right there. It's a crucial place to see it as it goes over to Romans 4. So in this deep sin, he is forgiven. A phenomenal thing, because God did more than not count his iniquity against him. He counted him as righteous. Premeditated murder, premeditated adultery, massive sin against a brother and sister. When you read it like this, you have to say to yourself, he's now declared a righteous man? After all of that? Well, yes, by God's grace. So no wonder is he so exuberant. Those terrifying dimensions of sin have been obliterated with three-part pardon. And you'll notice, if we're still looking at verses 1 and 2, that he uses the word blessed twice. Once at the beginning of 1, once at the beginning of 2. Blessed is the one, blessed is the man. But actually, you don't quite capture the joy in it, because those are plurals in the Hebrew, ecstatic plurals. The blessednesses of he, the blessednesses of the man. It is then a doubling of delight, and David's soul dances in ecstatic delight. He has been forgiven. Well, you say, why is he so exuberant? Well, I think I just said it, but it's because his forgiveness was not a sham. This is not a psychological Dr. Phil self-forgiveness or the communal absolution of Oprah, the high priestess of Western culture. It's real. And those terms, forgiven, covered, counts not, means one thing: real, objective forgiveness. And along with forgiveness, the king's guilt, this huge, throbbing, pulsing guilt, as we shall see, was gone. And then he'd been delivered from his soul's deceit. Says, in whose spirit there is no deceit. See that at the end of verse 2. I mean, it's amazing. I once, in my long pastorate in the Midwest, had an adulterous elder, unbeknownst to the rest of us, sitting on the elder board. Now, you're talking about deceit. He was so wrapped in self-deceit that the very day another one of our elders saw him with a prostitute in Washington, D.C., this same man who'd been with a prostitute flew home to the Midwest that night and chaired our evangelistic banquet to share the gospel. Talk about self-deceit. Because deceit is the currency of sin. You fall into it and give yourself to it, and you get so overcome with deceit. And there is relentless deceit and unconfessed sin. Self-deceit about your own soul. But along with that, a public deceit. Horrific. And then along with that, a really wicked domestic deceit to your nearest and dearest, guile and lying and cover up and hypocrisy and insincerity. And if you're like this guy, pious cant and talk. You could talk God talk any time of day, with anybody, wherever he had been, whatever he was doing. And those of us who are in sin and will not confess it, will not confess it, know what the psalmist is talking about. It is an orgy of deceit. It's like a carnival of deceit with big gaping mouths and trolleys going this way and things going up and down, darkness and blackness all around, an orgy of deceit. But oh, the release and joy to come clean. Well, David, He's really wants to get to us with his biography. He continues revealing his heart as he describes the guilt, what it was like of his unconfessed sin in him. And it's described in incredible terms in verses 3 and 4. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Misery. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away. Literally became old. Through my groaning, literally my roaring. That's the Hebrew. Roaring. All day long. I don't know if this is where George Eliot got her phrase. I don't think she probably had the Hebrew sense. But she talks about the guilty roar on the other side of silence that's in people's lives. And she said, if you could actually hear that roar, you would die from hearing it. It is so awful, so universal, the whole weight of the world. One man described to me his unconfessed sins by saying that when he shaved in the morning, he was living with guilt and lack of confession. He looked at himself in the mirror and he would moan at his visage in the mirror. So the physical effect as David is reached describes a feeling of desiccated bones, a miserable paresis of the soul, aching, rot. Such is the effect of bottling up guilt within. Psalmist goes beyond that. And he says about God, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. When God's hand presses our guilt on us, it is a grace because all of life is freighted with affliction, just being pressed down and pressed and pressed. That's what happens when you don't confess your sin, believers. Spurgeon says it perfectly. He says, better the world on your shoulder like Atlas than God's hand on your heart like David. And I want to say, because I'm addressing a whole group of people I don't know, and even if I did know you, I still wouldn't know, is God's hand heavy on you? Because of sin that you will not admit and you will not confess and you will not own up to, and you are obdurate and you won't do it. Well, may his heavy, unrelenting, leaden hand stay on you until you repent, because it is a grace. And David, bless his inspired heart, there's more, talks about how misery and affliction are capped with lethargy. Into verse 4, my strength was dried up by the heat of summer. Literally, my life juices were turned into the drought of summer. The whole of life was sucked out of his energy with his guilt. Entropy gripped his soul. He didn't feel like moving. Living was an effort. When I was studying this through, I made a little note. Isn't guilt wonderful? And it is. An inner howl, wasting bones, crushing afflictions, a troubled life, life's juices gone, a leaden soul. It's fascinating. You'll note there's a silat in the margin after all of what he says here. Like, think about it. Little music, background. And for some of us, this may be contemporary, present tense biography. Now, actually, guilt is a wonderful thing. We live in a culture that just wants to lift guilt off everything. Everybody is mutually not guilty, so to speak. But guilt is a wonderful thing. False guilt, not destructive guilt by feeling guilty about your parents' divorce that can weigh on you for years, or maybe some sort of guilt within the family for not being a great athlete, all 5 feet one of you, 110 pounds, or maybe getting a C in chemistry. It's not projected guilt, it's not self-imposed guilt, but what a gift real theological guilt is. That's a gift. It is a gift of grace. Real guilt for real sin. And what a grace is a guilty roar on the other side of silence. And to be pushed down by the hand of God so that you can hardly move because it's calling you to God. Now, if you're under that, if you're truly one of His, the misery will be yours until you repent. And if you're one of His, try as you escape, you'll never escape it. And if you won't repent, prepare to carry at a level misery and affliction and a sense of evacuation. Because guilt is good, and it's a grace of God. Well, after that first Selah, David records the final thought in his biographical sketch with a dramatic account of what happened in his confession. Verse 5, I acknowledge my sin to you, speaking to God. I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Now listen. In an instant, his guilt is gone. In an instant. There are some things that have to happen slowly. There are others that happen at once. And confession is now. And absolution is now. If you look at King David's biography in 2 Samuel, the 12th chapter, verse 13, you have David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord has also put away your sin. So confession, boom, forgiveness. Because God the Father is quick to pardon us, just as the prodigal son's father did when he interrupted his son's confession to assure him of forgiveness. That is something to think about. And you'll notice the margin again. Selah. Because forgiveness is only a millisecond away for every person here this morning. And I'm saying for a believer, and I'm also saying, and you'll hear it more, for those who have not yet come to a place of belief. I just want to say that your groanings can be turned into hymns in an instant. Your real guilt, what David calls the guilt of my sin, can be forgiven in the blink of an eye. And what you see in that marginal note, that Selah is as joyous as the Selah at the end of verse 4 is somber. Now we switch from the personal account of the king to David's experience in ringing challenge. Verse 6. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found. Surely, in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. Again, brothers and sisters in Christ, there is immediacy here. We're to pray while God can be found. It can't be put off, or hardness will set in. Famous text in Hebrews 3:13 reads, but exhort one another every day as long as it's called today, that none of you may be hardened by this deceitfulness of sin. Okay? And then two verses later in verse 15, he quotes Psalm 95:7-8 to make a point. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. In other words, he says, confession is now, the scriptures know of no other time, but now, today. Certainly before you lay your head on your pillow tonight. And if you do, the coming high waters of life, the chastening deluge, the ultimate judgment will not overtake you. It is now. So resolve by God's grace to do it now. Now, as David is getting into this, he's given his biography, he's challenged everybody, he's so transported by the reality of what he is writing or saying that he interrupts the challenging tone with a shout of praise. And you'll see that it's vertical to God. Verse 7, you are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble, and you surround me with shouts of deliverance. Well, he'd been trying to hide his sins. Now he says, you're my hiding place. I mean, what a change has taken place. And then his sins. He's trying to talk about how he, I'll say feels, we'll talk about it, how he feels. He said, I feel like I'm surrounded by people with shouts or songs of deliverance. And Charles Spurgeon, the great Victorian preacher, when he was preaching, gave it imaginative eloquence. He said this, the man is circled by song, surrounded by dancing mercies, all of them proclaiming the triumphs of grace. There is no breach in the circle. It completely encircles him around. On all sides, he hears music. Before him, hope sounds the cymbals. Behind him, gratitude beats the tremble. Right and left, above and beneath, the air resounds with joy, and all this for the very man who a short time ago was roaring all day long. What a change. What wonders grace has done and can still do. And I have to say, this is how the stubborn soul that finally confesses feels. Now I'm using that affective word, that postmodern lyric on purpose. It's how you feel. Have you ever, because of hidden unconfessed sin, wasted away in miserable silence while your soul groaned or had God's hand heavy on you, pressing you down until your strength was gone, and then confessed your sin? You remember the release, how you felt? Do you feel the reality? Do you want to feel it? You can. And he says, think about that. It's a law. Well, the challenge then picks up again, because he gets more intense, and his challenge picks up again with a solemn warning from God in the first person. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed with a bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. The image that God warns against, that of a stubborn animal. Don't be like a obstinate, stubborn mule or horse. You know, the metaphor fit him. When he went charging after Bathsheba, so to speak, he was an animal. And when he did not repent, he was like a stubborn mule. Brainless. So I want to say, let the stubborn sinner beware if he or she does not humble himself or herself and submit to God. May reach up a hand, discover a bridle over your nose, the taste of steel in your mouth, and you reach up a little further, you may find big long ears growing. As Martin Luther put it, we would not need to be treated like mules if there was not so much jackass in us. The Lord says he doesn't want to put bits in our mouth, doesn't want to put bridles on. He doesn't want us to reach up and feel those ears. He doesn't want to afflict us with the indignities, but he will do it if he has to. What a lesson to learn when you're a pre-teenager or a high school student or a university student or somebody as old as me. Well, King David then provides a brief two-part summary of the lesson of Psalm 32 in verse 10, and then verse 11 is an inclusion. It's a literary inclusion, you'll see. He says, first, many are the sorrows of the wicked. That's shorthand for everything he said. Many are the sorrows of the wicked. And I have to say, oh, the sorrows, the roar on the other side of silence, screaming conscience, audible groans, the bones, the inner frame wasting, crumbling, God's almighty hand pressing down with guilt ever heavier, the lethargy of a desiccated soul. Many are the sorrows of the wicked. But then the experience of the righteous in verse 10, but steadfast love surrounds the one who loves God. If you read your scriptures much, you know that steadfast love is always hesed, the covenantal love of God surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord, and that is what David experienced. And then the psalm ends the way it began in verses 1 and 2, in verse 11. Be glad in the Lord, rejoice all righteous, and shout for joy all you upright in heart. And well we should, because what David is taught in Psalm 32, and I don't know if you've got this yet, is at the heart of the gospel. You say, how so? King David had broken three of the Ten Commandments. He'd coveted Bathsheba, committed adultery, and murdered Uriah. And my fellow believers, if you've done those three, you've broken all the rest of them. And the Old Testament sacrificial system made no provision for such premeditated sin. If there ever was a premeditated sin, it was what he did to Bathsheba and what he did to Uriah. He thought it through. He worked it out. And there was no forgiveness. Nothing he could do. That's why in the other famous penitential Psalm 51, verses 16 and 17, speaking to God, he said, you will not delight in sacrifice or I would give it. You won't be pleased with a burnt offering. Then he says, I know the only thing I can do. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despise. His case was hopeless. Sin of a high hand. Nothing he could do, and he threw himself on God's mercy, and he was forgiven. David trusted in God alone for his salvation, and that is why, and here it is, that is why Paul quoted those two ecstatic verses of Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2, in Romans 4, 6 through 8, to show that David was saved by faith alone and counted as righteous. I'll just read Romans 4, 6 through 8, and you listen for Psalm 32, 1 and 2. David also speaks of the blessing of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from the works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. So there it is. It's quoted. And not only that, Paul adds a third blessing. You got tripling of blessing. Forgiven by faith alone, and not counted as sinful, but counted as righteous. So therefore, I want to say to all sinful humanity who labor under the roar of desiccating heat of their own sins, the blessing of forgiveness and the shouts of deliverance are available through faith and faith alone, and that's the gospel. And if you're visiting here this morning and you're not maybe used to this kind of straightforward teaching of what the Bible has to say about these things, but you're being drawn and you hear it, and I've been talking to the believers that haven't confessed their sins, I just want to say to you, it's true for you. All you need to do is look up to the cross and believe that Christ died for your sins according to the scriptures, and he was resurrected on the third day, and guess what? Complete forgiveness. Guilt gone. I've often walked down this street before, but the pavement always stayed beneath my feet before. But it's true. Complete deliverance from guilt. Hope of heaven. Heal him in your souls. And this is my gospel, says Paul, that Christ died for our sins according to scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was resurrected on the third day according to scriptures. That is the gospel. And brothers and sisters, I think you can say with me, I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. May God's grace go out to all of us this morning. Amen. Let us pray. Father, as we close this time together, I'm thinking about those that are on the fringes, those who are investigating Christianity and have heard things perhaps they haven't heard before or never thought about the depth of the gospel, but now are being drawn. We pray, God, that you would open eyes this morning, that lightning would strike souls with grace where they're sitting this morning, and that there'd be those who would believe. And for those of us who have been sitting on top of sin, trying to keep the lid down, who do have that screaming conscience and a sense of lethargy, we pray, God, that you would give the grace to do the right thing and repent. May your grace rest upon the body of Christ here. In Jesus' name, amen. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.